Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. This is the second video of the Learning and Evolving from a Past Practitioner series. Usually, there's a lot of snow in Montreal around this time. This photo is from last year around this time. However, we have been very lucky this year since we have not seen many major snowfalls yet. This is the photo from last week. But as I'm shooting this video, it's starting to snow again, so maybe I jinxed it. Anyway, if you enjoy the snow, you should come to Montreal in the winter. In today's video, I'd like to talk about Li Chunyi. If you are interested in the history of Xingyi, especially the Hebei-style Xingyi, Li Chunyi is a very important figure you should know about. Before we get started, let me give you a quick summary of my martial lineage under Li Chunyi. I studied under Hu Jinling in Tianjin when I was a child. He was a student of one of the Li Chunyi's disciples, Han Ziheng. Han was one of the Wu Ge Ye of five seniors of Xingyi in Liu Kuai village of Tianjin. Also, my grandfather worked in Li Chunyi's caravan company and practiced Xingyi and Long Xing Ba Gua Zhang or Dragon Style Palm. Topics covered in today's video include: first, Li Chunyi, Tianjin and Hebei Style Xingyi Quan. Second, Li Chunyi's favorite weapon and his nickname. Third, Li Chunyi's practice and contribution. Fourth, limits and further improvements. Fifth, Li Chunyi's life lessons. And sixth, demonstration from Li Chunyi's lineage. And seven, takeaways. So let's get started. First, Li Chunyi, Tianjin, and Hebei style Xingyi Quan. Hebei style Xingyi Quan takes its name from the Hebei province. It is one of the major regions in the north of China. Before 1912, when the Republic of China was officially formed, the city of Beijing, Tianjin, and most areas of the current Hebei province used to be a part of the former Zhili province. Then, in 1928, the government of the Republic of China decided to choose Beijing as the capital of the country, which resulted in the separation of Beijing from Zhili. And the new region was called Hebei Province with Tianjin as the provincial capital. Then, from 1949 to 1958, Beijing and Tianjin were considered as a municipality directly under the central government. In 1958, Tianjin returned to Hebei Province. Then, until 1966, Tianjin became a municipality again. The development of Tianjin can be traced back to about 1,000 years ago. Historically, Tianjin was the important area for the military. Most of the original residents in Tianjin area were military soldiers. However, the rapid development of Tianjin started about 600 years ago. The third emperor of the Ming Dynasty, Zhu Di, reigning from 1402 to 1422, usurped power back from his nephew, the second emperor of the Ming Dynasty. He rose in rebellion against his nephew from Hebei and attacked the old capital where his nephew lived. Eventually, he won the military campaign and became the Ming Emperor. Most of the Zhu Di's soldiers that marched to Nanjing with him were from Zhigu. Zhu Di considered himself as the son of heaven, and that is why he renamed Zhigu to Tianjin, or the part of heaven. From then on, and for most of the subsequent history, Tianjin served as a city in which governments trained military soldiers. Also, Tianjin was one of the earliest industrialized cities in modern China, if not the earliest. Given the special geographic location and the demographic structure of Tianjin, the city became a hotbed of many northern styles of martial arts in the last two centuries, including Xingyi, Baji, Tongbei, Lanshou, Mizong, and many, many more. The reason was very simple. Martial artists from other cities around it easy to make a living in Tianjin as compared to other cities, as martial art practice was a popular tradition of Tianjin. It's no wonder that many famous martial artists of the last two centuries lived and taught in Tianjin. At the same time, people from Tianjin have a bad reputation of being aggressive and short-tempered. But not me. I'm the mild-mannered Canadian gentleman now. Li Cunyi was and still is highly regarded not just for his martial skill, but more importantly, for being an educator and disseminator of Hebei-style Xingyi, who has directly or indirectly taught thousands of practitioners, among many famous martial artists who lived in Tianjin. And more importantly, he was one of the most important figures among them due to the fact that he is considered as the most important Hebei-style educator and denominator. Like I just mentioned that if we talk about Xingyi, we cannot ignore him. I have studied Li Cunyi's branch of Xingyi in addition to those of Zhang Zhaodong and Xue Dian. Li Cunyi's branch of Xingyi has a prominent position in the broader Hebei-style Xingyi. That's why I think it's worth talking about him and his practice. Li Cunyi was born in 1847 in Shenzhou, Hebei province. In Shenzhou, he was very lucky to practice Xingyi under Liu Qilan. He practiced under Guo Yunshen as well. Both Liu Qilan and Guo Yunshen were disciples of Li Luoneng, the founder of Xingyi. Later on, following his introduction with Dong Haichuan by Cheng Tinghua, he practiced Bagua under Dong Haichuan in Beijing. Later on, he worked as a military officer to train military soldiers in martial art in Tianjin as well as close to modern day Shanghai. Then he quit the Qing government official position and opened his own caravan bodyguard business, a business in which bodyguards on horseback protected valuable merchandise in transit. It used to be exactly like depicted in Kung Fu movie. Then he transferred ownership of his bodyguard business to his students in order to open the Zhonghua Wushihui, or Chinese Martial Artists Association, the largest martial art training organization of northern China in Tianjin around 1912. Li Cunyi was the director and Zhang Zhaodong was the vice director of the association. Feng Guozhang, the former president of the Republic of China, was the honorary president of that school. My grandfather told me that Li Cunyi taught more than 1,000 students in Tianjin. Li Cunyi breathed his last in 1921. He never had any child, but he had a few adopted sons. So, if anybody today claims to be a direct descendant of Li Cunyi, they are at the most adopted descendants, not biological descendants. Second, Li Cunyi's favorite weapon and his nickname. Li Cunyi's favorite weapon was the saber. His saber was custom made. The length of the saber handle was in between that of the typical single and double-handed saber. The handle was long enough for holding with both hands but short enough to stay out of the way when used with a single hand. This let him use the saber with either or both hands. In my opinion, the design and the construction of his saber was and still is superior to all other Xing Yi sabers. In his 50s, Tianjin was invaded by Russia. To defend his people, Li Cunyi, along with several of his students, attacked the Russian army in the Tianjin railway station area and killed hundreds of Russian soldiers. His saber was his weapon of choice. To express their admiration, people of Tianjin gave him the nickname Dan Dao Li, or Single Saber Li. Li Cunyi loved his saber practice. According to Confucianism, in ancient China, people placed a wooden frame or a plate with five characters written on it during important ceremonies involving worship. Those five characters are Tian Di Jun Qin Shi, or Sky, Earth, Emperor, Parents, Teacher. Like I mentioned in prior videos, until the last few decades, China had largely been an agricultural society for thousands of years. There were many methods that had been applied in order to maintain social stability. So, worshipping those five entities was considered as an important practice to consolidate the society. Li Cunyi described the saber according to these five principles. The blade represented the sky. The saber back represented the earth. The Dao Xin, or the saber guard to protect the hand, represented the emperor. The handle represented parents. And the scabbard represented the teacher, since it would be the part which handled the saber. What an interesting metaphor. A martial artist put his understanding of life into a weapon. When I was a child, my grandfather described the shape of the saber. Since my grandfather worked in his bodyguard company before and he saw the saber left by Li Cunyi, one day I hope to replicate his saber. 3. Li Cunyi's practice and contribution. Now, let's focus on his practice and teaching. First, regarding Li Cunyi's practice, I have to say that the approach to martial art practice in that generation used to emphasize hard training. Practice that really trained the body to become very solid physically and powerful in force release. I practiced under many of his grand students in Tianjin, such as Hu Jinling, Fu Shoubo, and Zhang Changtai, to name a few. Any of them told me that their teachers described Li Cunyi's practice as very solid, not the pathetic worm-like Xing Yi that is unfortunately rampant nowadays. The reason was very simple. During Li Cunyi's time, martial art practice was for survival, and back then, practitioners would just not be able to survive without solid practice. Second, the practice of Li Cunyi's branch should maintain the old flavor, a taut or testified body structure with a forward-leaning posture. Many modern Xing Yi practitioners keep their upper body fully vertical as their interpretation of the concept of the straight body. But in Li Cunyi's original flavor of Xing Yi, a straight upper body means that the back is straight without a curve, but not fully vertical. Let me show you a book. The name of the book is Yue Shi Yi Quan Wu Xing Shi Er Xing Jing Yi, or Yue Shi Xing Yi Five Elements, 12 Animal Essentials. This book was a teaching record of Li Cunyi written by his students, Dong Xiusheng. There are many old diagrams in this two-volume book, and it clearly demonstrates the forward-leaning body structure. Many Xinyi masters told me that this book was edited by Dong Xiusheng based on Li Cunyi's original teaching manual used at the Baoding Junguan Xueqiao or Military Officer School of Baoding. Baoding is a city in Hebei province. From this book, we can see for ourselves the old flavor of Hebei-style Xinyi practice. Also, please keep in mind not just Li Cunyi's branch, but also other branches like Zhang Zhaodong's and Xue Dian's branch emphasized having a forward-leaning upper body structure. The fully vertical upper body posture was created and popularized about 30 to 50 years ago, mainly due to the popularity and the influence of modern wushu. I can't emphasize this enough. Your upper body should lean forward. A fully vertical upper body structure is a mistake in traditional Hebei Xinyi, no matter what branch you practice. 3. Developed and enriched Xinyi and Ba Gua practice. Before Li Cunyi's time, Xinyi practice mainly focused on five elements, 12 animals, different routines, weapons, and applications. Since he traveled to many regions in China when he worked as a caravan bodyguard owner, he had many opportunities to interact with the practitioners of many different martial arts. Based on those experiences, he created very unique Xinyi practice such as two sets of Ba Zi Gong or Xinyi Eight Words, 24手 or 24 hands, which has been a very rare practice throughout the history of Xinyi. Please remember, Xinyi is the famous internal style not because it's routine, but because of its force training as well as its efficiency of training. It is based on some very effective training and single movement practice. Li Cunyi's 24 hand reflects this principle perfectly. Unfortunately, throughout much of Xinyi history and tradition, certain advanced skills were taught only to the most dedicated and skilled students. Because of this, many of these practices were not publicly taught. Li Cunyi also studied Ba Gua in Beijing under Dong Haichuan. Later on, he created his own Ba Gua practice named Si Men Long Jing Zhang or Four Gate Dragon Style Palm in Tianjin. Then his students Huang Bonian created Long Xing Ba Gua Zhang or Dragon Style Ba Gua Zhang based on his teaching and became popular in Tianjin. When I was a child, I practiced both routines and in my experience, both of them are simple Ba Gua with Xinyi influence, but neither is as developed as the Zhang Zhaodong's Xinyi Ba Gua Palm. Regardless, his effort in integrating Xinyi and Ba Gua together tells us a lot about his commitment to improving existing practice. By the way, back then, there were different types of dragon-style Ba Gua Zhang in Tianjin, and most of them were from the Li Cunyi line. When I was a child, I could see different types of demonstrations back then. Unfortunately, with time, those practices gradually became less popular. I think in the future, all of those practices will disappear eventually, which would be unfortunate. To summarize Li Cunyi's contribution to Xinyi, first, Li Cunyi promoted Xinyi in the Chinese Martial Art Association and taught many late famous Xinyi masters, including Shan Yunxiang, the founder of the Shang style Xinyi, not the same as Shanxi style Xinyi. 薛颠 founder of 象形术黄伯年 who created his own dragon style 八卦掌郝恩光 taught 形意 in Japan was considered as the first person who taught 形意 outside of China 傅建秋 who taught 形意 in Wudang Mountain and many others I will talk about some of them in a future video Second, Li Cunyi's 形意 practice focused on hard training, which emphasized a strong physical body and a strong power release or fa jin. Third, he also developed very unique and effective training method like 8-word set and 24 hands, which further enriched 形意 practice. Four.Limitations in Li Cunyi's practice and further improvement. If you ask me, is Li Cunyi's practice and teaching perfect? Well, my answer to this question is no. As a student of this lineage, I have to say that his practice was great, but from the neutral position of a Xingyi practitioner and observer, I have to say that his practice had room for improvement.If you observe practitioners in Li Cunyi's lineage, you will often notice their rib cages are to be very stiff, which is a very common weakness in practice. This weakness leads to poor coordination between the upper and the lower body, leading to a lack of fluidity in motion. This issue was pointed out by my grandfather, Yang Qinglin, as well as Mr. Hu Jinling. Indeed, this is a very common issue in most Xingyi practitioners. Of course, you can argue that this issue is caused by flaws in an individual's practice. But if it is a very common problem, then we can say that it is either caused by the design of the style itselfOf the propagation of a flawed practice over many generations, neither of which sounds good. Based on my personal experience and observation, the design of the style itself caused this issue. Fortunately, some masters of Li Cunyi's lineage, such as Xue Dian, found solutions to improve upon this issue. So, I think if you practice Li Cunyi's 形意,This is an aspect that deserves your attention in practice. I recommend you watch my prior video on Xue Dian and his practice. Link is in the description. To summarize, a common issue in Li Cunyi's practice is the rigidity in the ribcage area, which leads to a lack of fluidity in movement. Let me be clear.I care about the martial art and improving martial art practice. I respect and appreciate past practitioners, but I do not worship them. There is a big difference. Likewise, I hope a future generation of practitioners will continue to improve upon past and present practice. Fifth, Li Cunyi's life lessons. As a prominent third generation 形意 master. Li Cunyi firmly believed in 形意 its benefit and effectiveness. He did his best to promote and protect the reputation of 形意. He often said, 形意是国术,其他是武术, or 形意 is the national art. All the other styles are just martial arts. Of course,He had to back his claim even in his senior years. It would be considered a very extreme way of handling conflict in the community given his senior age, but it demonstrated his determination in protecting a style's reputation. Very often, one person becomes the face of the style. I think back then, he might haveintentionally put himself in the position of representing the entire 形意 school. We may criticize him based on this, but we should also consider the historical context. A martial artist devoted his entire life to a style which is definitely admirable in my eyes. The major function of martial arts practice in Li Chunyi's early year was survival. However, during his later years, martial arts practice had evolved to provide not only martial benefits, but also other purposes like maintaining good health and self-cultivation. Even though he did not emphasize these aspects, his hard work built a strong foundation for further development of martial arts practice as a way of self-cultivation. I call it modernization, civilization, and spiritualization of combat art, which was built upon the hard work of that generation, especially Li Chunyi. I feel we should remember, appreciate, and celebrate historical figures who contributed their whole life to develop the style such as Li Chunyi. Li Chunyi was not well educated compared to present standards. However, his explanation of a lot of Xingye theory, such as three stages of power, which include Mingjin, Anjin, and Huajin, or obvious force, hidden power, and neutralizing power, was by far the most detailed and clear. His contributions also included effective combat techniques like 8 words and 24 hands were innovative and creative. He continued to practice and improve his skills even in his old age. 6th, demonstration from Li Chunyi's lineage. I learned this exercise when I was about 13 years old from Mr. Hu Jinling. Li Chunyi's grand student Hu Jinling was very famous in Tianjin for his strong fajin practice. My grandfather sent me to him in order to improve my fajin since my grandfather was too old to demonstrate fajin by then. Mr. Hu Jinling studied under Han Ziheng, an important disciple of Li Chunyi in Tianjin. By the way, Han Wenshu, Han Ziheng's grandson, still teaches in Tianjin, and I'm in touch with him. In the future, I may interview him and ask him to share some of his practice and experience with us. This exercise is a combination of Tiao and Ding force, or upward strike and elbow strike. It is a single movement exercise to develop Fajin skill. Okay, I'd like to demonstrate a movement that is a combination of the Tiao and the Ding. Tiao is upward force, Ding is the forward force. So keep leg open like this. Then fan here. Then 1, 2. Okay, 1, 2. So. You can repeat this movement as many times as you want. 7. Takeaways. This was a very short video for such an important figure. There are many more topics that should be covered, but in the interest of time, I only picked a few topics that especially highlighted his contribution to the style. First, Li Chunyi studied Xingyi in his hometown, Shenzhou, and later moved to Tianjin and became famous as one of the most skilled Xingyi masters. Second, Li Chunyi's practice represents the old flavor of Xingyi, or the traditional way of practice. Third, Li Chunyi was especially famous for his saber practice, which earned him the nickname Dan Dao Li, or Single Saber Li. Fourth, Li Chunyi was also a great Xingyi educator since many famous Xingyi masters learned directly from him. So that brings us to the end of today's video. Thank you for watching, see you next time, and enjoy your practice.